Week in Press Audio presents What Works in Community News, Media Startups, News Deserts, and the Future of the Fourth Estate by Ellen Clegg and Dan Kennedy. This audiobook is narrated by Chris Baetens, published by Beacon Press Audio, 2023. Introduction. The local news crisis will be solved one community at a time. Friday, August 12, 2022, was a terrible day for Gannett journalists and the communities they served. A week earlier, the country's largest newspaper chain reported it had lost $54 million on revenues of $749 million during the previous quarter. The company's response was to lay off employees just as it had so many times before. Though Gannett would not release exact numbers, many who lost their jobs took to social media to share their bad news. By the end of the day, it was apparent that the cuts were broad and deep. From Worcester County in Massachusetts, where several small weekly newspapers were shut down and their staff members let go, to the chain's national flagship, USA Today. For perspective, Los Angeles Times reporter Jung Park observed that, after the cuts, Gannett's more than 200 daily newspapers and other publications employed fewer journalists than the combined newsrooms of just three national papers, the New York Times, the Washington Post, and the Wall Street Journal. And the downsizing continued, with another 200 or so jobs eliminated before the end of the year. In some respects, the layoffs were just another sign that the business model for local news is broken. According to a 2022 report by Penny Abernathy of Northwestern University, the country has lost more than a quarter of its newspapers, about 2,500 since 2005. Technological changes are responsible for part of the decline, but that's not the only explanation. Chain ownership by corporations and hedge funds has compounded the challenge by draining revenues from newspapers in order to enrich the folks at the top. Given that the economic prospects for the news business have been in decline for the past quarter century, it is fair to ask why investors who are mainly concerned about revenues and profits would want a piece of the action. The answer is that newspapers can still be lucrative for owners who are willing to cut expenses deeply enough. For instance, Gannett may be a money loser, but that is not so for its top leaders. Michael Reed, Gannett's chair and chief executive officer, was paid more than $7.7 million in 2021 in the form of salary, stock awards, and other compensation. Gannett's eight part-time board members received more than $200,000 apiece. The second largest newspaper owner, the hedge fund Alden Global Capital, which controls more than 100 papers, does not report earnings, but internal documents obtained by media analyst Ken Doctor showed that Alden's holdings produced an unconscionably high 17% profit margin during the 2017 fiscal year. As the headline of Doctor's column in Neiman Lab put it, Alden Global Capital is making so much money wrecking local journalism, it might not want to stop anytime soon. Moreover, both Gannett and Alden borrowed vast sums of money in assembling their empires, then gutted their newsrooms to pay down the debt. By contrast, independent, local, and regional news organizations are serving their audience by providing them with the news and information they need in a self-governing democracy. Some are thriving, others are just getting by. Many are digital startups, some are legacy print newspapers. There are hundreds of examples across the country, serving urban centers, affluent suburbs, and rural communities. In these pages, you'll learn about some of these projects, which we chose because they reflect a variety of business models, geographic areas, and demographic profiles. For instance, in New Jersey, NJ Spotlight, a nonprofit digital startup, merged with NJPBS, the state's public broadcasting outlet. The new entity, NJ Spotlight News, offers deep coverage of state politics and policy in the form of text-based stories on its website and a half-hour newscast that viewers can watch over the air, on cable, and on the operation's digital platforms. In Minnesota, a former reporter for Minnesota Public Radio and the Star Tribune of Minneapolis launched the all-digital Sahan Journal to cover the immigrant communities that are transforming the culture and politics of a state that is 80% white. By 2022, the journal had expanded its staff and coverage areas and booked grants from major funders. In Colorado, 10 staff members left the Denver Post following extensive cuts at the hands of Alden Global Capital, and then started a for-profit digital news organization, the Colorado Sun, which covers both the city and the state. After the owners of a media group comprising 24 weekly and monthly newspapers in the Denver suburbs retired, the Sun was brought in to help oversee them in return for an ownership share, thus staving off a corporate takeover. We would be the first to acknowledge that what critics sometimes call vulture capitalism is not solely responsible for the hard times that have befallen community journalism. When news began moving from print to the web starting around 1995, many publishers believed technology would be their salvation, as they would make money from interactive online advertising and cut costs by not having to pay for printing and distribution. It's no wonder that nearly all newspaper websites offered their journalism for free. The optimism of those early years, however, soon gave way to a bitter reality. Classified ads, which once accounted for as much as 40% of a typical daily newspaper's revenues, were wiped out by mostly free online services such as Craigslist. Moreover, about two-thirds of all digital advertising now goes to three internet giants: Google, Facebook, and Amazon. Many newspapers cut their staff to the bone in order to offset plunging ad revenues. Gradually, though, newspapers whose owners were willing to invest in the future began to find a way forward. As payment technology improved, many started to charge for digital subscriptions, thus offsetting at least in part the precipitous decline in advertising. They stopped cutting and began modestly rebuilding on the not especially esoteric theory that readers wouldn't pay unless you gave them journalism that mattered. They improved their websites and apps, cutting down on the pop-ups, pop-unders, and slow loading and scrolling speeds that had been the bane of online news. By the late 2010s, not only the national papers, but also large regional for-profits like the Boston Globe, the Star Tribune of Minneapolis, and the Seattle Times were back on their feet. What they had in common was committed local owners who were willing to be patient as their papers progressed toward profitability. The corporate chain owners, meanwhile, kept cutting. Then, cut even more as readers and advertisers spurned their hollowed-out papers. The result of this downward spiral was the spread of news deserts, a term that was apparently coined in 2011 by the blog Chicago is the World. The term refers to communities lacking a reliable source of news and information. Some news deserts have neither a local newspaper nor a digital outlet. Some have ghost newspapers. Penny Abernathy's phrase for papers that are filled with wire service copy and articles from distant parts of the chain with little in the way of local content. This is a book about democracy. Local news is essential to self-governance. Meaningful participation in civic life is impossible without it, as we depend on journalism to decide whom to vote for and to be informed about what's going on in municipal government, the school system, law enforcement, development, road repairs. The list is endless. Studies show that voter participation is lower and corruption more pervasive in places that lack reliable coverage. Ideologically motivated media websites with murky funding, designed to look like legitimate outlets, pop up to fill the vacuum. These sites, known as pink slime, are mostly, but not exclusively, on the political right, and they poison local discourse by pretending to be something they are not. Communities try to make up for the lack of news coverage by forming groups on Facebook and Nextdoor, sometimes providing useful information, but more often than not trading rumors and spreading misinformation. A healthy local news ecosystem is vital to community life, whose very existence is in danger as our culture becomes increasingly nationalized. We are immersed in big media, from the New York Times to Instagram, from the Fox News Channel to Netflix. Yet our most important relationships are with our families, our friends, our neighbors, and the places where we live. All these connections are held together by news and information that have little to do with Tucker Carlson's racist outbursts, who might win the next presidential election, or latest must-see viral video. This nationalization is being driven by technological advances, and there is nothing novel about it. Nearly 170 years ago, Henry David Thoreau lamented, "We are in great haste to construct a magnetic telegraph from Maine to Texas, but Maine and Texas, it may be, have nothing important to communicate." Perhaps not to each other, but surely among themselves. In the early part of the 20th century, the philosopher John Dewey pushed back against the journalist Walter Lippmann's anti-democratic assertion that an increasingly complex society would best be served by a government of experts. The media's role, in Lippmann's view, was the manufacture of consent, aimed at persuading an uninformed public to go along.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.